south of the border, down Mexico way. That's where I fell in love when the stars above came up to play. And now as I wander.
Hello there, all you expat wannabes. I'm Johnny Mueller, and you're listening to The Expat Files, Living in Latin America, the show that tells you just what it's like to live, work, play, and or retire down here in Latin America. It's a mix of the good, the bad, the ugly, and the great, and it's all right here, so let's get started.
All right, just a little announcement before we get started today. Now, as you longtime listeners know, my personal email address is theexpatfiles@gmail.com. So when you want to send me questions and comments, send them to theexpatfiles@gmail.com. I've had that email address for 10 years or so now. And even though I absolutely hate Google and the idea that they're running these free accounts and websites like they're doing us a favor. Meanwhile, we are the product and they're stealing and selling our data. But most of us do have Gmail, don't we? I'm still kind of stuck, as well as me and so many others who started with that service many moons ago. And over the years, I've accumulated so many tens of thousands of emails and files. You know as well as I do, it would really be a pain in the ass to switch to another account. Though I have a couple of paid email accounts that are encrypted, private, and secure. And you should too. That is, have a paid-for email service like Proton or Startmail. One that guarantees they're not selling your information or cataloging any of your information. But then again, it's going to cost you anywhere from $30 to $60 a year. You know, nothing's for nothing, and you're the product when you get a free email service. That's how they make their money. They sell you off to the highest, maybe even the lowest bidder. On top of that, they bombard you with junk mail and ads. So you can keep sending your questions and comments to theexpatfiles@gmail.com. But as for my personal website, that for a long time was theexpatfiles.com, well, just a heads up here. As of today, I'm ditching that one for various reasons, and my new website, now write this down, is expatplanb.com. Now, that's easy to remember. expatplanb.com. And if you go there right now, expatplanb.com, you'll see it does connect. You're on my homepage. And that's where you'll find my 2020 Latin American Healthcare Report. And that's where you'll find my updates and sign-up sheet, etc. for my upcoming July 2020 Expat Insider Seminar. And although the details haven't been announced yet, because we're 5 months away from when it kicks off in July 2020. Anyway, my new website, expatplanb.com, is where you'll find the details and updates. And if you're a longtime listener, you know I do those seminars twice a year. They're a week long and nearly always in the first or second week of January and July. So I repeat, my old website, theexpatfiles.com, has been changed. The new website is expatplanb.com. So as the upcoming seminar information gets finalized and some of my new reports become available, I'll be sending you to that website. All right, back to today's show. What are we going to talk about? Well, I've got a hefty backlog of emails and questions. So today we'll try to hit on some of the more interesting ones, like this one coming from Frankie. He says, Johnny, some Latin American freight forwarding companies ask you to email them a bill of lading. That is, I suppose, to give them advance notice of how much to charge you, as far as shipping and import taxes, etc. My question is, does it ever help to Photoshop the charges on that bill of lading you send them, you know, kind of knocking down the prices where you can? Or would you say it's futile because the original bill of lading is also included in the box with the item? So, Johnny, I was wondering if customs, or the aduana, as they call it in Latin America, still charge you import taxes on the original invoice anyway, even if you Photoshop the bill of lading and stretch it a bit in your favor? Thanks much, Frankie. All right, Frankie, thanks for those questions. Some of them don't have cut-and-dried answers, but I'll give it my best shot. Here goes. Frankie, I'm assuming you're talking about having things packed in your house up north in the States, then contacting a freight forwarding service and having the items shipped down in boxes. Or maybe even having a whole house worth of stuff shipped in a 40-foot container to your Latin American destination, which I would never recommend, not these days. Though years ago, when you just couldn't get U.S. appliances and electronics, it was very doable. But now you can get everything down here, so why would you want to ship anything but personal keepsakes? Now, if you're going to do it to save money, well, that's probably not going to happen. Why? You're looking at anywhere from $3,500 to $6,000, $7,000, or even $8,000 bucks to have a container shipped down, insured, and have the taxes cleared and paid in customs. And Frankie, you're almost right about those invoices. Everything has to be labeled and categorized on a bill of lading. Actually, you'll have to have two bills of lading, or a combined one in English and Spanish. By the way, I have an actual sample of a well-done bill of lading from a 40-foot container. So if you're interested in having things shipped down, whether a full container is worth, which I don't recommend, or just a couple of boxes full of useless Hummel keepsakes and grandma's hand-knit doilies, send me an email, theexpatfiles@gmail.com, and I'll send you a copy of a very nicely done bill of lading. Now, Frankie asks in his email, does it ever help to Photoshop the charges on that before sending it on? The thing is, if you're hand-packing stuff in boxes to ship, 99% of the time, that stuff's going to be used. I mean, you have it in your house, you bought it, and you've been using it, right? Now, if you do have something brand new and it's still in the box, take it out and make it look a little bit used. So when you're making out the bill of lading, you put down Whirlpool, microwave, model, whatever, X6718, used, approximate value, $25. In other words, lowball the hell out of it. And if you don't know the approximate value, go on the internet and check for a similar item on eBay or other places used. And how do you really know anyway? Suppose you had a set of dishware, a plate setting for eight, and you paid $200 for it. And now, 8 years and 27 cracks and chips later, the question is, what's it really worth? $10 maybe at a rummage sale? Now, the thing is, even if you're not shipping a container, which, like I said, I don't recommend, and you're shipping just a couple of boxes down, your best bet all around, unless you're shipping something very heavy like books or tools, is to box them up and tape them yourself, using boxes about the size of a large piece of luggage. Then you bring them down with you as extra pieces of stowed luggage. Assuming, of course, you pack the boxes yourself, you're going to fly back down to your Latin destination. Why not bring them with you? The thing is, as long as they don't weigh over 50 pounds each, they can fly with you as stowed luggage, and the cost, depending on the airline, from $50 to $150 each. All airline websites will have that info. Though, on average, an extra stowed box or bag will cost you around $100 as long as it's not over 50 pounds. Although, there are some much cheaper ways to go. For example, there's a freight forwarding service out of Miami to Guatemala and various other Central American countries called Transcargo or Transcargo Express. And since they're sending the stuff by boat, they don't charge by weight, but by volume. So 1 cubic foot, I think right now, is $14 with a minimum of 2 cubic feet. So you're going to be paying minimum $28, though it might take a month for to get from Miami to your doorstep. So how it works is you'll have to pack it and send it to their offices in Miami and they'll ship it from there. Remember, it's by volume, so there's really no weight limit. Within reason, of course. I mean, you're not shipping barbells, right? I hope not. By the way, some of these freight forwarding services, like Transcargo, when you consider that $14 per cubic foot fee, consider this. A large stowed piece of luggage is probably 5 cubic feet, which could cost you $100 or so as an extra piece of stowed luggage. However, if you sent 5 cubic feet by a shipper like Transcargo, that'd be 5 times 14 or $70, right? But here's the kicker. A lot of those services, like Transcargo, take care of all the taxes and aduana fees in that $14 a cubic foot. So if you use them, you'll never have to pay an additional import tax or aduana fee. Now, if you use a regular freight forwarding service that goes by air, like, for example, in Guatemala, there's a lot of them, but one in particular is called Rapidito Express, they'll charge you something like $6 a pound. And if the product, whatever you're having shipped, is worth $200 or less, you'll pay no aduana, import fees, or taxes. And it's all because of Amazon, like them or not. It seems the volume of packages now coming in from Amazon has forced most Latin countries to drop their import taxes on items under $200. All right, full disclosure here, as much as I hate Amazon, I still use them. So then how did Amazon pull it off? How were they able to get these Latin countries to drop their taxes on products under $200? Well, with the sudden influx in the last couple of years of millions of packages coming from the U.S., mostly from Amazon, the lazy-ass slugs in the tax offices and aduanas in Latin countries just could not handle the overflow. Now, what you have to know is there's a big difference between packing your own stuff in your garage or house in Cleveland, whatever, and sending it down to Latin America using a freight forwarding service versus ordering from a company online like Amazon and having it shipped directly to a Miami office, like the previously mentioned Rapidito Express. That would be a service you already set up an account with online. And by the way, Setting up an account with any of these services is free. Then, as mentioned in a previous show, you just use your own name, along with a code that the forwarding service gives you, along with their address in Miami, and you use it for everything you order online. Then the company like Amazon you order from thinks it's you at that address in Miami they're sending it to, where in actuality they're really just delivering it to a middleman, a service that sends your packages on a plane to your Latin country of choice. Then once it arrives, you get an email from the company telling you how much it weighs, how much you're going to pay, and they ask whether you want to come pick it up at their office or do you want it delivered, usually by motorcycle. And that costs you another $2 or $3. And believe me, even if it's something big like a TV, they'll bring it on a motorcycle. You ought to see those guys ripping down the highway with huge packages strapped to their rice burners. And yes, they'll deliver it by motorcycle to any place in your Latin American country. Or you can do what I do because I like to remain anonymous and always pick it up at their office so they never really know where you live. By the way, they've all got rules on how long you can leave it there without picking it up, too. All of these freight forwarding services have different policies, but suppose it lands in your new country, El Salvador, for example, and you're not there to pick it up. Maybe you're up in the States or on a trip to South America or Europe. Well, you have to check with your freight forwarding services because after a month or two or three, depending on the service and their terms and conditions, they own it, not you. But they're flexible, and this is Latin America. So if you send them an email saying you're out of the country and you won't be back for weeks or months, they'll hold it for you too, but you have to remember they all have a big room with lots of stuff in it that people have not picked up. And some of it will never get picked up. And you have to ask yourself why. Why order something and never pick it up? Well, I can tell you that almost never happens to gringos and expats because they do their homework. For example, I know of a Latino guy. He lives in Panama. He's bilingual. And a few months ago, he discovered Amazon. So he got on the Amazon website, bought himself a Stanley table saw. Was about $200. And in Panama's hardware stores, he found the very same saw for around $400. He thought, man, this Amazon thing is fantastic. He bought it online, had it shipped to the Miami office with his name and code and all that, and Amazon shipped it free to Miami too. And since it was around $200, he didn't have to pay any aduana or import taxes, and he knew that. So far, so good. But what he didn't take into account was the fact the thing weighed 65 pounds. And his mail forwarding service charged $6 a pound because, again, it was going by air, not by boat. You remember me telling you, you want to send big, heavy stuff by boat if you can. For example, using that previously mentioned company, Transcargo. So do the math. 65 pounds at $6 a pound? That's $390 for shipping. Plus the $200 for the saw? That's $590 for a saw he could have bought for $400 at the hardware store. So then what did this Latino guy do? This guy who thought he was so clever? When he got the email saying it was 65 pounds and he owed $390, he just never went to the office to pick it up. And with his shipping company, if it's there over 3 months and you don't pick it up, they own it. And believe me, they make out too, because think of it. He paid $200 on his credit card to have it ordered from Amazon, right? And the freight forwarding company that shipped it, though they charged $6 a pound to their clients, certainly only cost them probably $1 a pound to ship it. They rent space on a big cargo plane and just pack things in. So their total cost for the item, since it's already paid for, $65, or what they have in it for shipping, probably less. And now it's there so they can sell it new. I mean, hell, it's brand new in the box. It'd be an easy sell. Wait a minute, I know what you're thinking. Now that guy can never use that service again, right? Because he's got a piece waiting for him that he hasn't picked up, so he's proven to them he's a deadbeat. He left them holding the bag, so to speak. Well, the thing is, Panama's got at least 25 freight forwarding companies, so he can just move on to another one. So our clever Panamanian guy, who certainly learned a few things about shipping the hard way, after all, it cost him $200 and he's got nothing to show for it. Nevertheless, he can start ordering from Amazon again and be smart about it this time. But back to Frankie's original question about photoshopping the bill of lading before you send it off and therefore trying to pay less in aduana and tax fees. Well, like Frankie says, if you order something from the States, they'll send the original bill of lading down. So if it's over $200, the aduana and customs people will get a hold of it and you'll pay taxes and fees on that. And photoshopping won't help. Plus, if customs gets a hold of it, that's at least a week or two delay. But here's the thing. If you order stuff from eBay or Amazon, The stuff will almost always come in an Amazon box or an Amazon Prime box, and if you order a bunch of stuff, they'll combine it, and there will not be a receipt or a bill of lading from Amazon anywhere to be found. Though sometimes when you're digging through one of those boxes and you open up and you pull out the packing bubbles and all that, you'll find a receipt in there, but it's almost always deep down in the box and not pasted on the outside like a bill of lading. The fact is, and I order stuff from Amazon, I've never seen a bill of lading attached to an Amazon box, which does offer you a lot of wiggle room if you order stuff over 200 bucks from Amazon or eBay or any of the big outfits. Because what will happen is, when the stuff arrives in Miami from Amazon and they ship it off to whatever Latin country you're in, it'll end up at the airport. The customs and aduana people will come in and inspect the boxes. They'll see Amazon and eBay boxes, none of them with a bill of lading attached. They'll let most all small and light stuff pass right through. The stuff they figure is worth under 200 bucks. But they'll figure, for example, if they see a piece of machinery, it's worth more than 200 bucks. Or an appliance or electronic brand name, like Craftsman, Stanley, Panasonic, Sony, and many boxes with brand name stuff in them will have a picture of the tool or kitchen appliance, whatever, on the box. And the aduana and tax guys will spot those boxes right away. Though they probably won't open them. They'll ask the freight forwarding company for a copy of the invoice. That's happened to me a number of times. So, for example, and it's a real example, I ordered a certain brand name cordless drill for 135 bucks. Of course, down here in Latin America, you can get the very same thing for around 250 bucks, and it didn't weigh that much, only around 2 or 3 pounds. So I figured it was worth it because the shipping from Miami to Guatemala via my freight forwarding service was only 15 bucks. So I bought it, and it got hung up in customs because the picture of the thing was on the package. I got an email saying, "Send the invoice, please." I copied the invoice. You can get it right off Amazon. You just click a box. I saved it in a Word document, sent it to my freight forwarding service, and a few days or a week later, it was out of customs, with no extra fees or taxes because it was under the $200 tax limit. And of course, I provided the Amazon invoice as proof. Now, I think the reason why Frankie is bringing up the Photoshop angle is because, let's say, that drill was 300 bucks, and Amazon sent it to my Miami freight forwarding address, and they in turn sent it down to Guatemala, and it got tagged in customs at the airport, because they saw the picture of a name brand cordless drill on the box. They knew it wasn't a cheap Chinese no-name brand or a Black & Decker. Now remember, in this example, my Amazon receipt says 350 bucks. That means I'd have to pay anywhere from 15 to 30% combined taxes, import tax and value-added tax called IVA down here. One way to avoid those taxes is to take the Amazon invoice and Photoshop it. Now, I'm not advocating here that you do anything illegal, but believe me, people who know how to Photoshop are doing just that. And though I'm still not advocating you do anything illegal, I'm just telling you what many gringos and expats will do to avoid paying those taxes. And you know, anytime you're thinking of screwing around like that, you have to weigh the risk to reward ratio. So, in the end, what could they do if they found out you pulled something like that? So far, from what I can see, the worst they could do is hold it up for a while and make you pay taxes on the legit price. But could that really happen? If you're worried, all you have to do is make a quick trip down to the aduana office in any Latin American city. You'll see it's beyond chaos, a terrible mess. You got a bunch of lard-ass, pot-bellied slugs sitting around, watching soccer games, fiddling with their smartphones, surrounded by piles of papers and boxes stacked up everywhere. It looks at first glance they could never dig their way out of that mess. Sure, they've got computers and stuff, but half of them aren't working. I'm telling you, it's truly medieval. And by the way, almost none of them speak English. So when they do look over invoices from Sears, eBay, Amazon, you name it, they only see the numbers because the words are in English. So bottom line, what can I tell you? Don't do anything illegal, but it sure is tempting, isn't it? Especially here in Latin America, where it seems like everybody, and I mean everybody, is working some kind of angle to evade taxes. Then again, can you blame them? I mean, their government does absolutely nothing for them except steal their money. I know, that sounds all too familiar, doesn't it? At least down here in Latin America, the government only dips into your pocket for maybe 10 to 20%, whereas in the U.S., Canada, and Europe, every working person, and I mean every working person, is paying over 50% in taxes. And if you don't believe that, send me an email, theexpatfiles@gmail.com, and I'll send you a list of over 50 taxes you didn't even know existed, but you're paying whether you know it or not. So as it works out, down here in Latin America, you keep 80 to 90% of what you make. That is, if you're on the books. If you're off the books, you keep everything. Whereas if you're up in the States, you're working a half year or more for Uncle Sam. And what do you get for it? Nada. Oh, and by the way, the other day I just came across an article when I was checking how many employees and contractors work for the U.S. government. Now, this is really going to make you sick. It did me. For sure, this should get your plan B into turbo drive. Turns out the U.S. Embassy in Baghdad is on 104 acres. It cost nearly $1 billion to construct. And it has a staff and support personnel of, get this, are you sitting down? 16,000 U.S. government and U.S. government contract employees. Yep, you heard right. 16,000. You know what? That calls for a pregnant pause. I'll tell you, the U.S. has its own kind of cancer, and there's no cure for it. But figures like that are good to know, because the next time you get in an argument with someone who's defending the U.S. or the U.S. government foreign policy, or when you run into someone who says the U.S. military is a weak shell of its former self and it needs to be built up, just mention the 16,000 completely worthless U.S. government employees in Baghdad that you and I are paying for. Oh, and if anyone questions your motives as to why you have a plan B and you want to leave the late, great U.S. of A, go ahead and mention that magic number 16,000 again, followed by the phrase, I rest my case. And if they don't get it, there's no use wasting any more words. You're talking to a lost cause. You can bet they'll be going down with the ship, and you won't. Now, speaking of getting that plan B in action, here's an email from Clyde. And I'll paraphrase this a bit. He says, good day, Johnny, and happy new year. Hope it's a good one. I have a few questions regarding construction in Latin America. Apropos, coming on the heels of your solar and waterproofing episodes. I've been down here about 8 months now and decided I'm going to build rather than rent, or buy something that's already built. Prices are higher in Antigua area, but it's where we want to be, and the only way to mitigate that is to build, roughly a half to a third of the cost of buying new or used. Of course, it's in a guarded, gated community. Anyway, he says, we plan on building a 2,000 square foot home, and I'm a little confused as to how to estimate the amount of energy I will need for a house here in Latin America. Then he says, the websites for solar power calculators seem to focus on U.S. home needs, obviously not necessary in the Latin American Altiplano. So here are my solar energy questions. Number one, what resource or resources do you use to estimate the solar needs, specifically in the Altiplano region of Guatemala or Central America? What is recommended for a building similar to what I am doing, 2,000 square feet? Two adults, no kids, electric washer and dryer. Then he says that electric dryer is because I'll have free solar energy with panels. Then he says, I'd also like to size it for an eventual electric car, and currently we're using around 350 kilowatt hours per month. Then he says, number two, do you recommend a solar water heater and solar power for the remainder of the house? Number three, do you recommend one of those whole house instant hot water heaters or a point of use heater for each water source? You know, we call them suicide shower heads here, simply because you gotta see how these things are wired. That is, when they're wired by Latinos, not gringos. Then he says, are there any other factors I should consider? My second construction-related question is regarding closets. What is your thought on built-in wood closets, maybe cedar or cypress, or the beautiful wardrobes they sell all around here? I'm thinking it might be a good substitute to the walk-in closet. And he spells walk-in closet as walking closet. W-A-L-K-I-N-G. Not W-A-L-K-I-N, walk in. That's how clueless Latino real estate brokers, who are extreme gringo wannabes, unwittingly misspell it in their monthly glossy real estate magazines. The way they spell it, walking, W-A-L-K-I-N-G, is as if the closet has a brain and one day just decides to start walking around. Hey, I'm not kidding. I must have seen the word walking, W-A-L-K-I-N-G, as opposed to the correct hyphenated word, walk in, 100 times in these pamphlets. Man, are they clueless. Talk about not doing your homework. It's not walking closet, idiot. It's walk in closet. Hey, but that's why they call it the third world, right? All right, then Clyde says in his email, if we do build walk in closets, some sort of ventilation will be required as per your podcast. By the way, Johnny, can you recommend one or two shipping companies that ship via sea? Then he says, here are some updates to pass on to your listeners based on our own experiences. Number one, we are currently paying $158 a month for an 80-20 insurance plan. I'm 51 and the wife, 48. Our full coverage auto insurance is around $300 a year. We also open a bank account at GT Continental without a lawyer or residency. All right, me Johnny here. By the way, Clyde, good luck with that. You must know by now if you don't have residency, countries will just shut your bank account down arbitrarily because you're a gringo. But if you have residency, they won't and can't. Though I know you're proud of the fact that you opened the bank account all by yourself. Though I'm telling you, without residency to back it up, a bank account, even a long-term bank account, could get shut down at any time. Then Clyde closes out by saying, if you're up for lunch or coffee, let me know. Well, thanks for that email, Clyde. But I'll tell you, those questions are so specific to your case that I really can't do justice to them in this half-hour podcast. If you really want to dig into the details, we're better off doing a one-on-one consult. But I will tell you this, you're asking for trouble if you get an electric dryer, and I'll tell you why, and this is important. Suppose you're doing a couple of loads of wash and you have your dryer running for 3 hours in one day. Your average electric dryer uses around 3,000 watts an hour, so that's 9,000 watts if it's 3 hours in one day, right? Well, the truth is a very nice solar backup battery system for practically any house in the Latin American Altiplano would be rated at around 12 kilowatts. But when it's charged and ready to use each day or night, it'll only deliver about 80% of that because you don't want to drop below 80% of a lithium battery's rated wattage. And if by running your dryer 3 hours in one day pulls 9 kilowatts of the 10 kilowatts available, your dryer has pretty much depleted your battery for an entire day. That's why you should always get a gas dryer, and I'll tell you why. Because a gas dryer has an electric motor of about a quarter horsepower, or 200 watts. And if you use it 3 hours a day, that's only 600 watts. That's less than a tenth of the electricity consumption of an electric dryer. Because with a gas dryer, you get the real heat to dry the clothes with propane gas, which is very cheap and efficient here in Latin America, too. You know, for $50, you can get a 100-pound tank filled, and that'll probably last you 3 to 6 months. It'll run your stove, your oven, and your gas dryer. Of course, there's a hell of a lot more that goes into sizing a particular solar system for an individual house. We've just covered one tiny piece of it. Oh, and another thing, Clyde, I don't believe in full coverage car insurance unless your car is less than 3 years old. Why? Because car repairs here in Latin America are ridiculously cheap. So stick with liability coverage. You've been listening to The Expat Files, Living in Latin America. If you need some help with your own Plan B, we can schedule a one-on-one phone or Skype consult. Just send me an email, theexpatfiles@gmail.com. And if you want to get on the waiting list for my next week-long Expat Insider Seminar in Central America, where you're guaranteed to get a 2 to 5 year head start on your Plan B, send me an email, theexpatfiles@gmail.com. Nos vemos.